Okay, let's get started. The rods and cones, they have the photopigments. And the signal transduction part is the same concept. The light is going to hit the photopigments, and they're going to transfer them into the second messenger, second AMP, second GMP, and this second messenger is going to open, close some ion channel, trigger the signal transduction. So that's the signal transduction. The only difference is the first messenger is the light. And we have three different kind of cones, so each one sensitive to different kind of wavelengths. And we only have one kind of rods, so the rods use rhodopsin. And all the pigments, they only be able to be activated by visible light. So those 350 nanometer to 7 nanometer wavelengths, that's why we call them visible light. And the other electromagnetic wave won't be able to trigger the signal transduction, so we don't see the light. And rods and cones, they don't follow the traditional rule. The traditional rule is when you have a signal first messenger, it will bind with the receptor and trigger the second messenger, eventually depolarize the cell and neurotransmitter release. So more signal, more neurotransmitter release. And the rods and cones, they don't follow the rule. They create a dark current. When there is no light, actually they release a lot of neurotransmitter. When there are light, they release almost nothing. So they totally reverse it. They call it dark current. And the signal transduction part, let's look at the signal transduction. When there is no light, they have a lot of second messenger. And the second messenger is cyclic GMP. They don't use cyclic AMP, they use cyclic GMP. They really don't follow the rule. And cyclic GMP can open a lot of cyclic GMP gated ion channel. When this ion channel open, it's a non-selective cation channel. So calcium, sodium flow in. When they flow in, depolarize. When they depolarize, they're going to trigger exocytosis and neurotransmitter release. So when there is no light, when you are in a completely dark room, your rods and cones actually release neurotransmitter like crazy. When they are light, the lights come going to hit the rhodopsin. We use rhodopsin as an example, or the other three photopigments. It's going to decrease cyclic GMP. When you decrease cyclic GMP, you close the ion channel, hyperpolarize. When it's hyperpolarized, no neurotransmitter release. So it's totally reverse. It totally reverses the signal. We call the dark current. And this picture shows you the dark current. When there is no light, they release a lot of neurotransmitter. And when there are light, they release no neurotransmitter. And we all know the brain want to have a more stimulus, more action potential. And that's why on the retina, you have three layers. You have the rods and cones, you have a bipolar and the ganglia cells. Bipolar cells, their job is to reverse it back. So when they receive a lot of neurotransmitter, the output is nothing. And when they go to the ganglia cells can generate action potential. That's the third layer. And they receive nothing from the bipolar cell, and they can generate no action potential. So when there's no light, still no action potential. It goes to the brain know, oh, no action potential, no light. So it goes back to normal. That's why the retina needs to have three layers. And when there are plenty of light, it's going to hit the rhodopsins, and they're going to release no neurotransmitter. And bipolar cells reverse it back. So when they receive nothing, release a lot of neurotransmitter. When they release a lot of neurotransmitter, ganglia cells pick up those neurotransmitter, going to generate action potential. So a lot of action potential go to the brain. And the brain know, oh, okay, a lot of action potential, plenty of light. So it go back to normal in the ganglia cell part. And that's why the visual system, retina have three layers. And the other sensory system, they don't need to have three layers. They only need to have two layers because the rods and cones don't behave normally. And also the signal transduction. I told you there are five different kinds of cells, three layers. So we talk about the photoreceptor, we talk about the bipolar, the ganglia. We also have the horizontal cells and endocrine cells. Their function is peripheral. You found they don't send the signal from one to the other because we only have three layers, rods and cones, to the bipolar, then to the ganglia. Then what's the function of those horizontal cells, endocrine cells? Their job is lateral inhibition. We talk about this in the skin. They use this to increase the sensitivity. So through the lateral inhibition, the receptor field in the ganglia cells look like this. It's like this is the receptor field of this ganglia cell. When you shine the light to this area, this ganglia cell is going to do something. But do something can increase or decrease. Every neuron, they have the baseline action potential rate. They're going to fire maybe 5 times per second. They can increase. They can also decrease. That means that's the receptor field. And when the lights go out of this receptor field, they're going to do nothing. Because it's not their receptor field. It's the other ganglia cells going to change their action potential. And they found this is the receptor field of this ganglia cell. It's not the more light to it, the better. It's actually, they want to have the light in the center and the dark in the surround. They call the center surround receptor field. You say, why do this? Because if you create this kind of receptor fields, or you can shine a 10 candlelight in the center and 0 candlelight in the surround, and the difference is 10, it will give you the same response. Then you can shine 100 candlelight very bright in the center and 90 candlelight in the surround. It gives you exactly the same response because the difference is 10. The reason is your sensory system, your visual system care about the contrast. They don't care too much about the absolute light level. So you're actually not very good at detecting the absolute light level. So you are able to read in the indoor with very dim light. You can read outdoor with very bright light. And if you like photography, you found that the camera setting indoor, you could not bring it to outdoor. It's too bright. You have to change the setting. And for you, you don't feel too much difference in your eye because your eyes start to ignore the absolute light level and focus on the contrast. Because the contrast will give you more information. A black and white bear, no matter it's indoor or outdoor, well, your visual system won't be able to tell it's a bear. It does not care if it's a very bright bear or very dark bear because the contrast is the one give you more information for survival. So we're going to do an experiment. It teach you, you suck at identifying the absolute light level. Your visual system is not so good at identifying absolute light level. You're more good at identifying the contrast. So these two, actually, they're the same light level. I know you don't trust me, because this will look much darker than this one. They are the same light level. So we're going to do an experiment, and we have to block the surround. So that's why I put all this, right? Okay, ready? So focus on A and B. I block this. You can do it by yourself. Okay, now the B look darker. Almost. Magic. That's the same light label. And when I bring them back, well, okay, it come back again. So this tells you your visual system is not so good at identifying the absolute light level because on the retina level, you start to give up the absolute light level. You only focus on the contrast because the contrast will give you more useful information for you to survive, not the absolute light level. Okay, now let's go to the color vision. Color vision is a privilege. We have color vision. We are able to identify fruit, food, different kind of color. If you don't have color vision, we do have some animal or some people, they don't have color vision. A black and white bear still look like a bear. So it's a privilege. I call it a privilege. And we actually not having the best color vision eye. We have a very good one. We're able to have the color vision because we have three different kind of cones. So the blue cone, the green cone, and the red cone. The red cone is not red. They show you their best wavelength to activate the red cone is about the yellow to orange. But we like to call it the red cone. So when we look at the color visions, what is human's eye? We have three different kind of cones. We're better than dogs. You may heard that dogs are colorblind. They are not really colorblind. They just see they have two different kind of cones. So it's like I ask you to paint with the blue and the red ink. You can create some wavelengths. Their world is not as vivid as yours. But they never know what it means because they never see the other color. Compared with bees have one to see the UV, so they're able to see the UV. And the birds actually have a better visual system than we do. And it makes sense. They are able to, they need to be able to identify the food and the prey, so they have a better visual system. This little guy, his mantis shrimp, he has 12 different kind of cones. Wow, I don't know why they need so many. And compared with the humans, they have 12. They have UV and many UV, the light, the purple, the green, and then one for longhorn color and the infrared. So the world must be beautiful. How beautiful it is, I don't know. I never see the UV light. And if you miss one kind of cones, you are colorblind. Like, could you read this number? Or if you can read it 74, you are not colorblind. It's genetic. So people with colorblind, they can miss any one of them, but most people miss the red cone. That's why they use this kind of task. And that's how the colorblind people look at this picture. Like, it's like I ask you to paint, and I don't give you the red cone, so you can still create certain spectrum. And that's colorblind. It's genetic, so they never know what they miss. And eventually, okay, the visual, the light gonna go to the retina, from the retina go to the optic chiasms, go to the thalamus, from the thalamus go to the visual cortex, and the signal will be analyzed there. Visual system is pretty expensive, so all the process start from the visual cortex. And the right visual field go to the left visual cortex, left visual field go to the right visual cortex. And they start doing process, combine these two images in V2, in V4, in V5, V5 also called the MT. They start to process pretty late. So it turned out, if the animal does not have a good visual cortex, they just couldn't afford this kind of expensive toy. And that's why some animals, like a frog, they don't have a good visual system. This is for people, for rich people. So like primates, we have very good visual system. And we talk about the depth perception is recreated by your brain, because the signal, the 3D signal go to the retina. Retina is two-dimensional, so you have to recreate depth perception. And that's why some artists can play with the visual system, like they can create, because your retina is two-dimensional, so they create this kind of statue, so the impossible triangle. Why is it impossible? Because it's actually not a triangle. It looks like this. So you have to stand here, and when this image falls on your retina, it looks like a perfect triangle. And some of them play with the painting, because as the dental viewpoint, and the rhythm is the same, because your retina is two-dimensional. So they can paint, this is painting, they can paint it and make it line up perfectly on your retina, and suddenly it creates a 3D vision. It's actually the painting. That's the painting. So they have to paint on the floor, and you have to stand here, and they will force you to use one eye because it's easier. And suddenly all this image fall on your retina perfectly, and you start to see a 3D. So they have to paint it. It's a big work. And that's another one. That's another one. So this is painting, and this guy's real. So from this side, it looked like a perfect swimming pool. But if you go to the other side, it actually looked like this. Yeah, so you have to stand there and look at this. It looked like perfect painting. So a lot of artists, the visual system, as I said, the visual system is the main system used in primates, especially human. We have a very good visual system. So this also the system we understand pretty well. We understand pretty well. And we one reason is this is our main system, and second reason is we do a lot of research of it. And of course, we found a lot. Then we're going to talk about the auditory, got to talk about the chemical senses. We don't know too much about the chemical senses. Okay, I think that's it. And compare with the other systems, the visual systems been processed pretty late. So they're not being processed in the brainstem. Then we talk about the auditory. They're more affordable toys. So means they start to process, identify the location of the sound in the brainstem part. There's a big difference between the visual and the other system. Okay, that's it.